Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the Tuesday, December 12, 2006 School Board meeting. The reason that I am taking over this evening in the beginning as superintendent is because this is the evening we elect a new board chair and a new assistant board chair. Since our former board chair and assistant board chair did not run this time, why I do not have them to do that job. So we'll start the meeting tonight. I'll start it by having the election of the chair and the vice chair, and then I will turn the meeting over to the chair at that point in time. Would you please all stand with me and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I will do a quick board attendance. When I call your name, if you could just indicate if you're here. Trish Brigham, who I know is late and will be here in a few minutes. Karen Burke.
Here.
Peter Carter.
Here.
Rebecca Millett.
Here.
Kathy Ray.
Here.
Kevin Sweeney.
Here.
Linda Winker.
Here.
Thank you. I would like to open the meeting this evening and seek from the board a nomination for chair of the board for 2007. Do you have any nominations?
I nominate with pleasure Catherine Ray as the next school board chair.
Second.
Thank you, and we have a second. Are there any other nominations? Then I would ask for a vote. All those in favor of Catherine Ray to serve as chair? The vote is 6-0 because we have one member missing. I would now open the nominations for the election of the vice chair for the school board for the year 2007.
With equal pleasure, I nominate Trish Brigham to be the new vice chair of the school board.
Thank you. And a second?
Second.
And Linda's a second. Are there any other nominations? All those in favor of Trish Brigham being the vice chair of the school board? Again, 6-0 with one member absent. So, Kathy Ray, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to turn over the chairmanship of the school board to you. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Just briefly, I'd just like to say that I'm very honored to be elected chair for this coming term, and I look forward to serving with my new fellow board members. Well, thank you, Mary. Have you changed my name? First of all, I'd like to start with adjustments to the agenda. We have two, I believe, Alan.
Yes, that's correct. One that we need to look at based on last night's town council meeting is we need to look at the naming rights and sponsorship agreement for the new turf field. So I would suggest that we look at that under communications and make it 6C under that if we could. And the second ones that I have are under recognition. I have several other recognitions that I will go over that tonight under number 8. And I will also talk briefly about the under number 9 school report. No, excuse me, under number 8 under the superintendent's report. Also speak briefly about the SAT scores.
Alan, I have a question.
Yes.
What is 6B?
6B is, I'm sorry, that's another addition. Thank you. I have it written down, but I forgot to mention it. 6B will be mentioning the SAT scores. So take that one that I put in the superintendent's report and put it there. Is B is SAT scores. I wrote that earlier and forgot that I'd written it.
Thank you, Alan.
Question.
Yes.
As we anticipate perhaps taking action on 6C, should we also add that action under new business?
We were going to add it under new business, but I think we discussed doing it earlier rather than later, so that if there was anybody here interested, yeah. Thanks, Kevin. Okay, approval of the November school board minutes. Do I have a motion?
I move that we approve the minutes as reported.
Thank you.
Second.
Any discussion, additions, omissions? Okay, all those in favor? Thank you. Okay, comments by high school and middle school students. I guess we'd start with the high school. Would that be Rosie Weinberg and Dally Gruen? Yes, no? Daly?
Daly.
One second. Put you on the spot, walk in the door. Don't give you a chance to sit down. Thanks.
I was just at the girls' basketball game.
Uh-huh, well, that's important, too.
Yeah. So we've just had a couple bomb scares, and that's what pretty much the biggest thing that's been going on, but I think those didn't turn out to be anything special. But what we've been doing most in the SAC is we've talked about maybe getting, looking into ways of having a student member on the school board, and maybe not a voting member, maybe, but we'd heard the idea, and it has happened in other towns too. And we just thought it'd be a really great way to get students some say in what's going on. And even if it's just listening in and letting everyone know what students would think. We're looking into lots of different ways of doing it, ways of choosing kids, ways of what we hope to get from it. And so we're looking into a lot of different setups for it. We're also discussing some. We've discussed that there's not that much life to the school this year. Not as much as always. So we're just looking for ways to do stuff like that. Like we're hoping to have a really good Winterfest this year, and we're just trying to liven things up. And that's about it.
Great. Well, the school board can have a discussion about the addition of a student to the school board, and we'll get back to you folks.
Oh, great.
Can I see you for me?
Yes.
By way of history, as I guess I'm the definitely the historian now, I guess it was, Jeff, 2 years ago when I was chair that we entered into this conversation with the student, Elaine and myself representing the school board.
Okay.
We had a very positive discussion, but at the time the students felt that it was too big of a task to take on. I'm glad to see that the SAC is thinking along those lines again. It's certainly important. I had both my services, both for the board and the SAC, as a liaison in helping them put together their plan to bring forward. So.
Great. Thank you, Kevin.
Thanks. We really appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Next would be the middle school students, Michaela or Will, and or Will. Both here. Okay, great.
Hi, Will Daly. Recently we had our second school dance, and this dance was a half an hour longer. Unfortunately, the turnout was a little low because of other activities that were going on that night. But it was pretty strong from a standpoint of profit and as well as behavior. Also, our school store is up and running well, and soon we'll have clothing options available for the students. Recently, the 7th and 8th grade took the NWAs, and personally, I thought those went really well. Tomorrow, we have an earlier release, and the last day before vacation is December 21st, so of course everyone's looking forward to that. Soon, on December 18th, the PowerSchool gradebooks are going to be open to both parents and students so they can look at that from home. And hopefully this will allow students to become more independent in their schoolwork and working by themselves. On that note, report cards were sent out last Friday, and the new trimester started on December 4th. Also, we recently had a math meet. The seventh grade team finished first. Notably, Paul Hemreski placed third, and Ethan Danino finished first with a perfect score.
Great. Thank you, Will.
Hi.
Okay, well, the 5th and 6th grade social, sponsored by the Student Council, is at Vacationland Bowling, and it's this Friday, December 15th. The bus will leave at 3 o'clock, and we'll get back at around 6:30, so parents should be at the pickup circle at this time. The 5th and 6th grade math team meet every Thursday from 2:30 to 4. Their next math meet is January 18th at the Portland Expo. The three categories are arithmetic, geometry, and team problem solving. The speech and debate teams have practices every Tuesday from 2:30 to 3:30. Their next meet is Wednesday, January 24th in Yarmouth. The Cape Elizabeth Middle School just hosted a speech and debate meet on December 6th. For the debate team, they will be arguing the following resolution for January and February. We resolve that strong academic performance be recognized by a published honor roll. The Nordic skiing season just started, and 40 kids are on the team, and they practice a couple days a week. The girls' 7th and 8th grade basketball season began in November. There are 31 girls, 22 of which are 7th graders. Each team has played 6 games so far in the season. The 5th graders are doing an integrated unit, which is when all of the students work with each of the 5th grade teachers. And this unit is called the Acadians, and they will have some guest speakers, such as a musician and two women who will demonstrate spinning yarn. And next Wednesday, the guest speaker will be Mr. Hawkins, who will be sharing artifacts with all of the 5th graders. On Friday, the 5th grade will elect their two student council members as 5th grade representatives. And the student council has decided to donate a painting to the Center for Grieving Children. The student council now has a web page on the middle school website. And also, I'd like to thank the school administrators and teachers for how well they handled the school evacuation 2 weeks ago. And in addition, I would like to thank South Portland for accommodating our students. That's it.
Great. Thank you, Michaela.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, we'll be moving on then to communications. Alan?
The first piece in your packet is a letter of resignation from Miranda Hammond, who is an educational technician at the middle school. Basically, what I do is bring these to you as technicians just to let you know. And she is leaving middle school to go on to a 5th grade teaching position at Guy E. Rowe Elementary School in Norway. And later on this evening, we'll also be talking about a replacement position with that. The second piece that I have this evening is, after months of you asking me the question, have the SAT scores come in? Yes, they have. They finally have arrived. But what we have done is they come to Jeff and to myself. The first thing that Jeff has to do is review them for any questions. There were some questions about them. Those questions have been returned to the state. We'll be waiting for a response on those so that in January, we will bring the actual SAT scores to you so you can take a look at those based on our school's performance, but also in comparison with other schools of approximately the same size. But we do need to wait for that final. I think there were 6 to 8 questions that needed to be answered before we will have a final set of scores on those. The third piece that I have for this evening is the addition to the agenda. For those of you who may have been watching the town council meeting last night, the naming of the new field, the turf field, was brought before the town council. I would just like to comment on it briefly and then to go into some more specifics. If you were listening last night, you heard the new chair of the town council read a statement about the naming of the field and the sponsorship agreement that went with it. The proposal is to name the field the Hannaford Field, and it is in honor of the Hannaford family who have been very active in this town over more than a century. Originally starting selling gardening crops out here, eventually part of that family expanded into what we now know as Hannaford Brothers. They are major donors to the turf field, and so after much discussion, the decision was that field would be named in honor of the Hannaford family not of the company, but of the family. What is important for me to note here is that back when the turf field issue first came about, which was shortly after the decision to put lights on the field, and there was a group of people who were involved in raising funds for that, the decision was to expand from there. At that point, Graham Smith, who served on that committee, started another committee to start raising funds for the turf field. I've had correspondence from systems all over the state who are absolutely shocked that we are not diving into school board money and we're not diving into town council money in order to do this. The turf field has totally been privately raised money through the community. We are now at $650,000 for that. The move next is to get the field put in place. The hope is that with that money raised, that we'll be able to pay the first down payment, and that the first laying of the field will come in March, or as close to that as possible as the new field it gets freed up from ice and snow. So that is the plan. But personally, having worked with this committee for a long time, I would like to say a very special thank you to them. I think it's very important that you as a school board and I recognize the enormous amount of work they have done to make this happen. The naming of the field has become somewhat of an issue because it was brought last night. The decision of the town council was that issue be returned to the board to take a vote. The board did vote 7-0 in favor of passing the naming of the field, but felt they needed a vote from the school board first. So that is why it's been brought here tonight. The board members have in front of them the speech that was given by the chair of the board last night about the naming of the field. They also have the contract, which is a naming rights and sponsorship agreement. And the other piece that I would say with this, and I've had opportunity to talk to with a lot of people since last night's meeting, is that knowing our town manager as well as I do, and knowing that the town manager does everything possible to ensure that CAPE receives appropriate recognition, he negotiated this contract. And I want to thank the town manager, Michael McGovern, for his work. I had met with him several times, as I have with the committee, in order to make this possible. I would also mention that I do have with me this evening, part of this whole plan is a new scoreboard, which is the Hamilton scoreboard. Those of you who look at it carefully will see a Coca-Cola sign on it. The Coca-Cola sign has been replaced by a water sign for the company's water sales that they do, so that it will not be a Coca-Cola sign. So this is the one that is proposed for this place as well. So I bring this information to you so that you have that. I would say to you that Elaine Maloney, Ann Belden, Kevin Sweeney, and I served on the turf committee for the community during the process of the last year in order to get to this point. So I give that as opening information for you to open up at that point in time to make any recommendations and any questions and discussion at this point in time.
Linda?
I'd like to make a motion at this point in time that I enthusiastically move that we approve the proposal for the naming of the new turf field as the Hannaford Field in recognition of Hannaford's historic connections in this community.
Is there a second?
I'm pleased to second the motion and would like to add my admiration, state my admiration for everyone who's been involved with this particular project. It's gone off as planned. So I am seconding the motion and will be voting enthusiastically in favor of it.
Thank you, Kevin. Discussion? Questions? Discussions?
I actually do have a question and something that was raised as we were discussing this today after learning that we would be taking a vote on it last night. And it relates to a concern on the part of several of us that we develop a district policy regarding corporate naming of school property to address these issues as they arise in the future.
If I could speak to that too, I talked with Karen earlier today about that, and I think she's right. I think one of the things that we're finding is we enter the 21st century, is that monies that were once available for schools and school systems become harder and harder to come by. And so we are going to need to look at more corporate sponsors, more companies to work with us. And I think an important question that Karen raised, and I think a couple of the others of you raised also, is when and where do we begin to talk about the naming of things based on the monies that come in? And so I think it's a very important school board issue, and I do think it's one we need to pursue and get a policy in place. I think one thing that goes with this agreement is the fact that the naming of Hannaford Field will be the name of the field. There will be no naming of pieces to the field. There can be plaques on the field in honor of somebody, but the field will be the Hannaford Field, and that is set in the agreement itself. But I think as far as doing some work around future planning for future boards and future superintendents, I think it's a very wise move.
Kevin?
Karen, and everyone, as a point of information, I responded directly to Trish. I didn't have the time to transfer the email from one account to the other, where I know you all get copies. But in any event, I suggested to Trish that I agreed entirely, so I agree with you as well. Since this supersedes just athletics and goes far, far beyond that, I'd recommend, and I believe Trish agrees, that this belongs in the policy committee itself rather than student activities or any other place we have to talk about those things. So I will be supporting that when the conversation is held.
Okay. Rebecca, did you?
Well, I think this is obviously an amazing accomplishment by the TURF committee, and a great deal of credit goes to the people who served on that and the people who made donations. So I don't want them to feel that these comments that I'm going to be making is directed at their effort. It's more about the process that we as a board need to go through in the future. And I know last spring when this first came to us, I requested of the board that we not be put in a situation where we had to make quick decisions without full information. And unfortunately, that is the fact tonight. As far as my personal situation goes, I was informed of this at 2 o'clock this afternoon, and I had not seen any information at all relating to the turf field for months. So I know everybody's really busy who's been on the committee, but I'm concerned that now that there's discussion about signs and there's already sponsorship for the sign, the scoreboard, and I've seen no information relating to that until tonight. So I'm going to reiterate what my main concern is. We are going down a path before policy has been set. We are going to be creating precedent tonight by this vote, and that will in and of itself set policy. And I'm very uncomfortable with this as a process for the board. So for whoever continues to work with the TURF committee and other future committees that are involved in fundraising for the schools, I would ask that we try to keep all board members informed as much as possible. I do believe, from what I could see in the contract, that this appears to be a corporate sponsorship because it requests us not to have other pharmacy names or supermarket names, et cetera, et cetera. So while this may have initiated from a family aspect, the contract itself, I believe, makes this a corporate sponsorship. The fact that there is a contract actually probably makes it more than just a simple donation. So we are embarking down the path of accepting corporate money for school property or activities without having had a full board discussion about how comfortable we are with that. And I regret that we're in this situation.
Anybody else?
I would just like to say thank you for articulating that so well.
Anyone else? Okay. All in favor? let's see, six, I can count, six, zero, because Trish isn't here. Thank you. Before we move on, I have been remiss. I did not welcome our two new school board members. I am so sorry. Tonight, we recognize that Karen Burke and Peter Cotter have joined us on the school board, and it's really wonderful to have them here.
Thank you.
Welcome.
I apologize for not doing that up front. I was a little nervous myself. Okay, moving on to comments from the public on non-agenda items. Is there anyone from the public here that wants to comment on a non-agenda item? I see no one, so we will move on to recognition. Alan has some recognition.
Yes,
to
I do.
Discuss.
I have one that's mentioned here, and I have some others that have been added in the last few days, just so you know it. I would comment on the fact also, the board has spent a lot of time talking about how we do recognition and doing it more frequently. So one of the things that we have designed now is a letter, and it's kind of a certificate, which is signed by the board chair and the superintendent, that will go to people who we recognize just as some kind of a piece to go out to them so that they will have it to hang on to. I'm sure they will hang them all on their walls and in very expensive frames. So we'll work that our way through that. The first one that I have tonight is one that is not on the list, but it is in honor of David Weatherby. If you know David, he has been very active in sports, both as a student here and then in recent years in coaching. And just recently, he was selected by the Maine Sunday Telegram as Maine Cross Country Coach of the Year for 2006. So although David is not able to be here tonight, I wanted to recognize him and the work that he has done with our cross country team. Remember that they went to California to represent us during this year. Also did very well in the state level and the New England level, and came in third in New England, behind two schools from Connecticut, if I'm not mistaken. So I just want to be sure that David recognizes how much you as a board appreciate the work that he has done for that committee. The two high school ones that I have, had an email a few days ago about two of our high school teachers who have been extremely active with the Day One program. And the Day One program is a program that deals with students who have substance abuse problems and other problems that make at times school very difficult for them. The first one is for Katie Lisa. And if you know Katie, Katie is at the high school, and Katie is a real leader at the high school. I don't think any of us who have ever dealt with Katie would say any less of her. She's an amazing person. Katie has worked in their programs called Making a Difference Award, and is recognized for 15 years of continuous experience in their natural helper program. And the other night she was honored, along with our next person, at a banquet for the work that they have done. The second one is Andrea Kayer. If you know Andrea, she is the health teacher at the high school, also very active, very highly regarded by everyone at the high school. She has also been a Day One natural helper for 20 consecutive years. From what I understand, these two people have the longest consecutive service to this program of anyone in the area. And so this also honors Andrea. I talked with both of them. They both had commitments tonight, but I told them we would be mentioning them tonight and thanking them for all the work they have done. So again, I would like to thank them for that. I also do read the newspaper every now and then. Don't always get to it, but I do every now and then. And the Forecaster this past week honored two students from Cape Elizabeth as male and female athletes of the year. The first one is Marla Houghton, who is the fall female athlete of the year. She's a senior soccer player in the Western Class A Regional All-Star program. The other one is Graham Egan. And Graham is a senior cross-country player in the Western Maine Conference All-Star First Team. And I also have certificates for them to recognize them. I'll also pass these on to you just so you have them as a part of your packet. And finally, Trish has not arrived yet, but she also sent an email on to me, which I think is very important. Trish asked that we honor tonight those people in our schools who have done so much work to help people in the community. And so what she sent to me is a list First of all, from the high school, the students and faculty who are involved for Coats for Kids. The second one is the food drives from Pond Cove and the middle school that were held around Thanksgiving time. The third one is Adopt a Family Holiday Program from the middle school. The fourth one is Preble Street Resource Center for toiletries and socks collected, which is ongoing. And the last one is from the Cape Coalition, who sponsor programs at the soup kitchen towards gifts for Iraqi soldiers, etc. And I think it's very important that we recognize that we have students and staff who are very active in these. I am sure, I'm always nervous when I do this, because I know for everyone I said, there's another one out there I don't know about, but I wanted to be sure I at least got this information out to everyone as we honor people from Cape. I think I see some of you as another one.
Well, no, actually, I just would say that if people are aware of those that we've missed, please let us know so we can acknowledge them in the future meetings.
Great. Thank you, Alan. You notice that I keep you busy talking
tonight. Yes, I noticed that tonight.
That's because I can't talk. Okay, moving on to the superintendent's report. Alan, you wanted to talk about the November 29th emergency?
Yes, I do. I think I take it a little more seriously than was commented on earlier tonight. But I do want to comment on it because I think it's extremely important. I think what I would first say to you that the day of November 29th, when we first received the call and then went through the process that we went through, was an extremely difficult day. It was a difficult day in many ways. It was moving students and staff to different locations. It also, the evacuation itself, caused a great deal of disruption for people. In that same process, though, I want to take a minute to be sure to thank the families out in Cape Elizabeth who honored our request to not come and get their students. It was extremely important to us that we keep students together, that we manage the day carefully. It was also important to keep students together because when you're in this situation, we need to be absolutely sure that they're all very safe. So I want to talk for a few minutes about emergency planning and what we do. Back 2 years ago, just prior to my coming, Mark Tinkham, who was at that point the assistant principal at the high school, and John Casey became involved in building an emergency plan for the school system, recognizing the fact that no matter what we build, we can't build something that does everything. But to be sure we had plans that worked around both the evacuation of buildings, also if we had to do a lockdown in our buildings, that we would be prepared for those. Last year, we did several meetings in order to review the plan, to enhance the plan, to increase the plan as we moved along. This fall, with Mark leaving, John Casey said that he would chair this committee. We had had a couple of meetings this fall, and in those meetings we began to talk about those things that we were going to do with staff to extend their knowledge and to do the planning that was necessary. We had done a very in-depth meeting in October with that group. We also had people from the community, Russ Webster, who is a member of the community but also has a strong background in security and works at Logan Airport, joined us and offered an enormous amount of help for the process. And so in October, we had this long meeting. We made some new decisions. We made some plans as far as where we go ahead. And on November 21st, there were some meetings in the schools as we worked with staff to begin to understand some of the issues we have. I think what is interesting is these things. When I came on board, it was made very clear the board had voted that every staff member wear these. Some staff members wore them, some staff members didn't. It became an issue for a while, but I also made it an issue that they needed to be worn. These became very important on the 21st, and I'll talk about why they became very important. So anyway, we had on the 20th finalized plans, which included a revisit of places for evacuation. Evacuation had been planned last year for the high school to go to South Portland High School. And the reason we did it, we didn't have enough space in this town to evacuate that school. South Portland High School offered us the opportunity to use their auditorium, which having lived in South Portland, 799 people, which fit our students and staff very well. Pond Cove had arrangements to go to St. Bartholomew's Church. St. Bartholomew's was willing to accept us this year, and Cindy Perkins had been out there to make arrangements, be sure everything was okay. Our third place was going to be the Community College in South Portland. However, at the last minute, we had to make some changes, and we ended up using Memorial Middle School, which obviously I'm very familiar with since I was principal there for 13 years, but it also became an excellent place for us to go. On the 21st, we had redone all of this, had revisited all those possibilities, and on the 29th, I got a phone call, I believe from Jeff, to let me know that we had an issue at the high school. And I got to the high school, and we had an issue. We had not a typical note. Most of us who have dealt with bomb scares and those types of things, the normal process is a note probably written over a men's journal or on a bathroom wall or something like that. This was a letter. It was a fairly long letter. It was a letter that not only threatened bombs, but also had some information in there which made us very nervous about what may be happening in the fields around us at the same time. At that point in time, we met that morning. We had the police with us immediately and the fire department. The police did an investigation of the fields to make sure everything was safe. The other piece that was very necessary for us is we are very clear that we do not have enough CAPE buses in order to transport the number of students we needed to transport. Backing up from this for just a minute, going back to the middle school, the initial plan for the middle school had been to walk to the Methodist Church. We had talked about that last year, Steve and John and I, very uncomfortable with students walking anywhere in this type of instance. So that's when we moved to a school and a place to get away. So the other problem was busing. And fortunately, again, I want to thank Wendy Houlihan, who is the superintendent of schools in South Portland. Not only does she offer the high school, not only does she offer Memorial Middle School, but she offered the services of South Portland buses. So that morning, when we knew we had to evacuate, when we knew we wanted buses as close to the buildings as possible, when we knew we wanted to use other exits, a caravan of South Portland buses came out. My understanding is they came with a South Portland police car at the front of the caravan and at the back of the caravan to make sure it got through here without any stopping of traffic. They arrived. We boarded buses at the high school, at the middle school, and at Pond Cove, got students moved to where we needed to move them to, and got them settled into their new, in quotation marks, homes. With that, I need to say to you very clearly, and I was glad to hear one of the students say it as well, I can't thank enough the people in South Portland for the work they did with us. Without ever questioning us, with opening the doors, they had people there to greet us, they had people to work with us inside the buildings when we got there. Once we were there, we did take the high school students to the theater. We took the middle school students to Memorial's gym, and we took Pond Cove to St. Bart's, and I think we used most of the church for that day. I got a chance to visit the high school while they were out. I got a chance to visit Pond Cove. I didn't get a chance to visit Memorial because of everything else that was going on at that point in time. But I want to tell you very clearly, and I think it's very important to understand, in a very, very, very difficult situation, your staff and your students performed very well. You need to understand that as someone who was in South Portland as a teacher and as an administrator for many years, there was a piece of me that was very nervous about this because these people were going to former schools that I had worked in. I have had nothing but the greatest of praise from the people in the schools, and I've had nothing but the greatest of praise from the people at St. Bart's as well. Probably the piece of the process that was the most difficult for us was the communications piece. Fortunately, most people understood the communications and worked well with us. We had some complaints, but it was very clear to us that we needed to review and revise those. One of the things that we did is we kept the students at the buildings where they were evacuated to. We transported them home from the two schools. The high school was open so we could take the high school kids back, get their bags, get their cars, and send them home from there. But at the end of the day, after all was said and done at 4 o'clock, The entire committee of administrators, police, fire department, et cetera, met with me, and we reviewed all of the steps in the process. We reviewed the steps that went well, and there were many that went very well. Not happily, for my part, but they went well, and I'm thrilled with that. But there were pieces we needed to work on, and we have worked very hard to revise that. What you see laying in front of me here is the emergency planning book. This book will takes us through every single step of the process. One of the major parts of the process that became very difficult for us is I didn't stop to think how many high school kids have cell phones. And I also had not stopped to think how well high school kids recognized there was a problem even before we had said anything, from the simple picture, as Mr. Henninger said, of seeing the principal, the assistant principal, the superintendent, the fire chief, and the police chief all arriving at one time. So that even though we were on the top floor, the very end of the bottom floor had a very clear idea something was going on. The use of the telephones became a problem for us because they jammed our phone lines before I could even get to my secretary or secretaries in our office to give them information. Pauline and I were down at the high school and trying to work our way back at that point in time. So we knew we had a serious problem there, and one we have managed to take care of. So in this book, there is a step-by-step-by-step process to get consistent information out. We now have a website on our school system website. There is now a way, if there is an emergency plan, immediately there is a signal, there is an emergency, a parent goes in and hits that, and it opens the site which says every step of the way, what we're doing, where the kids are, where, how they're being taken to, what's going to happen. We've also, through Pauline's work, have changed all of the phones in our schools so that now, if there's an emergency, when a parent calls that phone number, instead of getting a secretary or someone, it will say, if this is an emergency situation, please press, I think it's 6 on some of them and whatever. And they can immediately get consistent information on what is going on, which is extremely important in the process. We have looked at the steps as far as evacuation. We have looked at some changes. For instance, one of the things that will happen in our schools, if, and I say that if very carefully, if this ever happens again, so that there are signs that go on the doors of every classroom that will let people know there's something in my classroom I think you need to look at, or my classroom is fine. So we have done an enormous amount of work around that. We have also taken a look, I've been working with technology people to look at what if we lose electricity at this point, how will we deal with that? And we are looking at this building right here is connected to a generator. We have got to get our computers across the system connected to the high school generator to avoid any problems like that. But it has been an enormous, enormous learning experience for all of us. And I just would like to mention a few people so you will know who's played a major role. First, here in South Portland, it has been Tom Eismeyer and Cindy Perkins who have represented Pond Cove and have done an enormous amount of work with Pond Cove staff to continue their planning. To John Casey and Julie Salikas at the middle school, who have overseen that program, and obviously Steve working very closely with them. To Troy Henninger at the high school as the assistant principal who is overseeing that program. To Paula Harris, who is a nurse at Pond Cove and at the high school, who has also worked very closely. Paulina Portria, who has become, along with Dominic, my seconds in command, and so they will pick up pieces. There are pieces each of them will pick up to make sure everything is carried through from there. Ernie McVane, who is the head of maintenance, who has been was very active and has continued to be very active in this process. Chief Neil Williams and the Cape Elizabeth Police Department, again, having been someone who has been in other towns, I can't stress enough the high quality we have of our police department. They are there at a moment's notice. They are there to brainstorm with us and work through it. And also Chief Phil McGuldrick and the fire department, who would come in if we have had a major issue occur. And of course, I can't miss Sue Weatherby, who has an amazing sense of coordination and pulls everything together very well. I would also just like to say a very special thank you to people in South Portland, to Wendy Houlihan, who is the superintendent of schools, to Ron Deegan, who is the transportation director and who was there at a moment's notice to help us, to Jeannie Crocker, who is the principal at South Portland High School, to Wendy Welter, who is the memorial principal, to Monsignor Michael Henschel at St. Bart's and his staff, and to Martha Spencer, who heads up the food program in South Portland. They all played a very important role. I also received the other day a letter from, I said Wendy and I meant Megan, I also received a letter the other day from Megan Welter, who also mentioned other staff members at her building who worked very carefully. But I would like to read a statement that she made. I did, however, want to make sure you knew how wonderful everyone was. The people here were so impressed with your staff. They were really struck by the way that your staff were so devoted to the work of the day. Your students' outstanding behavior also set a standard for all of us. And that really made me feel good, particularly because that was my school for a long time. I would say with these, State Police, because if you aren't aware, we had the Cape Elizabeth Police, the South Portland Police, and the State Police inspecting our buildings, and they also brought dogs. The State Police were very quick to say what wonderful things these were, because they could identify right off quick, these people are Cape Elizabeth people, this is their name, and this is what they're doing. And so that was a very important piece to that. So the 29th was a long, long, long day. We're all exhausted. We are now gathering the bills of what it costs for that day. South Portland served the high school and the middle school lunches that day. They went ahead, fed their own people, and then went ahead and fed ours. We got food over to Pond Cove, so those kids were fed. So there are bills for that. There are bills for overtime for both Cape Elizabeth bus drivers and South Portland bus drivers. I am figuring that we will probably have several thousand dollars worth of bills as a result of this, which I think is very important for you to understand, and I'll have a direct bill with you once everything is done. But I think it's very important to understand that what somebody may have thought was funny cost this system both the wear and tear on our young people from kindergarten to grade 12, the wear and tear on our staff enormously. And it was a foolish measure. And I will be very clear, I've said this to the newspaper and I'm going to say it to you. If and when we catch the people who did this, I will take the maximum legal action necessary, because they have done something that put a lot of people in danger. And there is no question in my mind. I will tell you that yesterday we had another bomb threat at the high school. Because it was a bomb threat that was this time written on the wall with a pen, and it was a threat against the high school, and it was for today at 4 o'clock. We did the investigation. The police came in last night, investigated the building. This morning, enormous number of police were at the building. Investigation was done. My understanding is, if we have not, we are close to finding the person who did it, and we will take the action necessary, and hopefully we're getting closer and closer to the person who did the first act as well. If you watch the TV tonight, bomb scare number 7 was today at USM. I don't want to live that same history here, and so we need to do everything we can to avoid it. In closing, what I would say to you is this. As a superintendent, this is something you never want to do. Unfortunately, it's the second time I had to do it, once in my other district as well. I would say to you, the cost of this was high. For those of us who are at the age some of us are, this added another 20 years to our life. It took another 20 years off our lives. And for some of us, we can't afford to do that, to say the least. So, but it was a terrible situation. And I would say, and I hope, that it is the end of the situation here in Cape Elizabeth. However, I would also say to you that if it does happen, we have people well prepared, the plans are there and ready to move, and we are going to continue our training, we're going to continue the work we're doing to constantly make sure we are ready for any emergency when it comes, and do the very best job we can. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. Moving on to the school report, the Pond Cove School Induction Program. Tom?
Good Good evening, and welcome to Karen and Peter, his new board members. Congratulations to Kathy. Before the teachers who will be doing the presentation, just a few words about tonight's topic, which is teacher induction. Strictly speaking, the term is confined to teachers new to the profession, but in our case, we've expanded the program to include teachers new to Pond Cove and teachers who have changed grade levels. That second group is particularly important because of the tighter standards we have in grade level curriculum. It also fits nicely with our one of our goals of our future direction plan, which is to attract, retain, develop, and supervise the best possible staff for the Cape Elizabeth schools. Just a little history. This idea of having a more formal induction program started a few years ago. We had had turnover, particularly in one grade, because of retirements. And although we go through a rigorous screening and hiring process, we realize that after hiring people, they might not necessarily know how we do business with things like, say, for example, guided reading at Pond Cove. The then teacher leader, Kelly Hassan, worked with the reading teachers to conduct what we call mini workshops during the school day, which worked really well, and urged and arranged teachers to visit each other and to visit teachers who had been around Pond Cove longer. From that successful but modest start, we thought it would be better to build a more formal system. Kelly applied for and got a grant from CEEF, which again included the efforts to have discussion groups besides offering people the general orientation about policies and procedures. Time during the day for observations have been more standardized, and we've connected the teacher induction program with the mentor program. We've also clarified with the inductees how the induction program relates to the supervision and evaluation standards, at the same time trying to meet individual needs about a teacher's strengths and weaknesses. We also discovered we had a grant for about $6,000 for the first year, but it turned out it's not all that expensive. We are still using the money for the grant that started 2 years ago because a lot of the effort comes from personal energy. And the costs for the program really are substitutes for visiting during the day, some stipends, and we also have offered targeted professional development and workshops outside of the school. Two second grade teachers have graciously come tonight to offer their personal experiences. This is their second year at Pond Cove, so kind of veteran teachers now. So Tara Bucci and Lisa Derman will explain how they have been through the induction program.
Hi, I'm Lisa Derman. I'm now a second year second grade teacher at Pond Cove School. And Tara and I came here together. I think we're both honored to have the opportunity to speak with you. We're both second year, second grade teachers of very different backgrounds. Tara is an experienced teacher who's worked in a number of school districts. She came to Pond Cove, brand new to Pond Cove School. Last year was my first year having my own classroom. However, I had a lot of experience at Pond Cove School. I've been affiliated with the school in one way or another since 1995. So it's interesting that for the two of us, this induction program has been really useful for both of us, even though our backgrounds are so very different. I have to say that being a new teacher is not easy. And even though I was very familiar with Pond Cove School from being a parent volunteer and a substitute teacher and in special ed tech and a long-term sub, it's different coming in and being a full-time teacher, and there's a lot to learn. And it was great to have the induction program to help that along. We started off by having lunch together, all the new teachers and Tom, just as a way to meet each other, start discussions going, feel like we're part of a community. After that, we've had monthly lunches on our early release days. Instead of each of us having lunch individually, we've gathered together. We just brought our own lunches. Becky's been wonderful about providing desserts, which is a great incentive. And we've had just relaxed, informal conversations. They are confidential so that we all feel happy to say what we have to say and ask questions that we want to ask without worrying about it going outside the four walls of that room. And it's been a great community-building experience and a great opportunity to get our questions answered. Early on in the process, we had a questionnaire given to us saying, you know, what do you need? What information do you need? And I remember at the time saying, I don't even know what I don't know. I don't know what to ask. But being in a room with a lot of other new teachers and experienced teachers, people started saying things, and they would bring something up. Well, exactly how should the regular education teachers be working in conjunction with the special ed teachers? And I say, yes, that is a question I want answered. And I think that was a lot of people's experiences. Having everyone together to discuss things gave us the opportunity to realize what things we needed to know. And what was especially wonderful is then we could get the questions answered. Right after we all brought up that we wanted to learn more about how regular education and special education work together, Roxy Johnston came to our next lunch and talked to us exactly about that and fielded all of our questions. We had questions about the evaluation process. Tom came to our next lunch, and again, he spoke to us, and we got to ask a lot of questions of him, and those got answers. We got to express what we needed to know rather than having someone say to us, you need to learn this, which was great. We got to go to some workshops, and I'm going to leave it to Tara to talk about those so I don't hog everything. We also got to go observe teachers who have been teaching at Pond Cove for a long time. And as Tom mentioned, there's a lot to learn. It's also important that we were asked what we wanted to see. I chose last year to visit other second grade teachers in their guided reading to see what they were doing in their guided reading, both what they were doing with the students they were working with in the group and what the other students in the classroom were doing while they were doing it. So I got to see Sarah Lewis and Talia Edlund, and I learned a tremendous amount from those visits and got to speak with both of them afterward to ask, why do you do it the way you do and what are the benefits, and had great conversations about that. And on Thursday, I get to have my needs met for this year, having seen two second grade teachers in action. My question this year was, okay, what happens in third grade? What am I preparing my students for? So on Thursday, I'm going to get to visit Mary Dulac and see how she does her guided reading, and I'll have time to meet with her afterward and discuss any questions that arise from that. And I'm going to stop talking and let Tara go ahead.
I would also like to begin by thanking Tom for inviting us to be here. We appreciate him, as well as Becky and Cherry for helping us out with this inductee program. Lisa and I are very grateful to be new to Pond Cove. I feel as though I'm really blessed to be part of the staff there. This is my second year at Pond Cove, and hopefully just the beginning of a big, long future. Let me give you a little bit of background about myself and my prior teaching experiences. Prior to Pond Cove, I spent 2 years in the Portland Public Schools teaching primary special ed in response to intervention and training for reading. Before that, I was in Fairfax County, Virginia, where I taught in the general education classroom for 3 years with special ed inclusion. I am an experienced teacher. I have 10 years of teaching experience. This means that I do not qualify for a mentor here in Cape Elizabeth. However, there's a lot I need to know about Pond Cove Elementary School and the Cape Elizabeth school system. I'm an inductee, and my purpose this evening is to show you how the inductee program benefits the teachers, the school, and especially the children here in Cape Elizabeth. As Lisa was saying, luncheons were provided, and we were able to decide on some important things. One were the visits. I was able to go and observe a teacher above me, again, with the reading program, and a teacher below me, and one in third and one in second grade, to see where the students have come from and where they're going to. We also were able to meet and talk about the new curriculum, the formats for instruction, and the new report cards, and how those would benefit us to learn the program and the system and the computers. As a result, in a need for the direct observation, the mentors of our inductee program set up substitutes and times for us to switch in the classrooms and to go and observe. These observations were during school hours and gave us provided us a time to be able to speak with those teachers afterwards, which is most important. Not only is it observing, but able to communicate about what they were doing and why they were doing it, like Lisa said. After our luncheons, we also discussed how we might need to travel outside of the school community to learn more. We discussed about workshops that were available. One of the workshops that we were interested in is time management. Just as many people want to know about time management, we were really interested in how teachers can do it all. We learned they can't do it all, but we learned how to work towards doing more and during our day. We also learned about the Katie Wood Ray writing instruction program that complements our Lucy Calkins writing program. We were able to go to Freeport for a day among a group of colleagues who are part of our team as well as the new inductees. From the information, we were able to come back to the school setting and teach others about her writing program that complements Lucy's. Inductees were given permission to attend these workshops as well as were provided subs. These opportunities are very outstanding. Why do we need a program like this? It provides support for teachers without mentors like myself. It provides a social group of peers besides just the team members. We do rely heavily on them. It provides a sense of community among the new teachers, and it fosters professional development and growth. I hope that you also agree in supporting new teachers who are new to Pond Cove and not just to the educational community, and I thank you for your time. If you have any questions about our inductee program, I'm sure there are many people who would like to answer those questions for you. Back to you, Tom.
Combination of shyness and self-confidence. Also, besides thanking Lisa and Tara, Becky Swift, teacher leader, is here, and our halftime library media specialist and co-coordinator of professional development and curriculum, Shari Robinson. They've been the energy behind it. Tara and Lisa mentioned some of the values, but I said induction is not just for new teachers. We'd like to think we're inducting teachers into our budding professional learning community at Pond Cove, which means having a shared mission and values for the school and the district, engaging in collective inquiry, which you can hear that they've done, understanding that we work collaboratively, being action-oriented, being committed to continuous improvement, and because we're focusing on data this year, results orientation. Good intentions are not enough. We really want to see results in teaching and learning. Just to remind you, it doesn't cost much to keep this going, and I recommend that we consider institutionalizing this for the whole district. I think it would be a wise investment. Some of us heard Michael Fullen talking a few weeks ago. It's not just about the money, it's about the investment in energy, and I've heard that at the Future Direction Planning, too. You can tell we have enthusiastic teachers new to the building, and our veteran teachers are just as excited. I'll field any questions, I suppose.
No questions? Thank you, Tom,
thank
and
you
Lisa and Tara.
Thank them, yeah.
Okay, moving on to unfinished business. The first part is board appointments. Thank you. The school board met informally last Thursday, and put together a list of committees and appointments and advisory committees for this coming year. And unless anybody objects, I'd just like to take this as, I'll read through it, take it as one group, and then we'll look for a motion. Yes? Change.
Well, I just realized a couple of days ago, which I emailed to Alan, that it's not a really critical position, but we did leave off legislative liaison.
Oops.
And I've done such a stellar job, I'd like to float my name again, if that's okay, as the liaison. But I actually do have an idea that I passed by Alan, so hopefully we can maybe do a little bit more this year.
And since I'm legislative liaison for Cumberland County Superintendents, we'll talk a lot.
Well, wonderful.
There you go. We'll put that on the list then. Thank you, Rebecca,
okay,
for pointing that out. Okay. Committees, standing committees. Communications Committee, Trish Brigham, Chair, and Karen Burke. Finance Committee, Rebecca Millett, Chair, Kevin Sweeney, and Linda Winker. Personnel Committee, which includes the Sabbatical Committee, Linda Winker, Chair, Peter Cotter and Kevin Sweeney. Policy Committee, which includes the Calendar Committee, Trish Brigham Chair, Kevin Sweeney and Linda Winker. Strategic Planning Committee, Trish Brigham Chair, Karen Burke and Kevin Sweeney. Student Extracurricular Committee, Linda Winker Chair and Peter Cotter. Wellness Committee, Rebecca Millett, Chair, Karen Burke, and Peter Cotter. Positive Action Committee, Kevin Sweeney, Chair. Appointments, Paths, Kevin Sweeney. Volunteer Advisory Committee, Karen Burke. High School Forum is going to rotate with two school board members each month. Curriculum Committee, Karen Burke and Rebecca Millett. We have no chair on that one, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And Town Comprehensive Plan, Elaine Maloney. I may mention that the reason it's a non-school board member at this point is because Elaine has worked on that committee for about 2 years, and that committee is nearly finished. And for continuity, we want Elaine to continue on in that capacity. And Advisory Committee, Technology Advisory Committee, Linda Winker. Do I have a motion?
A legislative liaison.
Oh, sorry, Rebecca. You know, I wrote it on one sheet, not the other. And Legislative Liaison, Rebecca Millett. Thank you, Mary. Now do I have a motion?
I move that we accept the board's recommendations for appointments to the various committees and appointment committees.
Thank you, Kevin. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Rebecca, even though I missed you. Any discussion? All in favor? Thank you. Okay. Policies for second reading. Trish?
A little nervous here. This is my first time. I have huge shoes to fill after Ian. I think for the second reading, the policies are competitive food sales, IKF early graduation, IL evaluation of instructional program, ILD student surveys, IMDB flag displays, and JL student wellness, KCE receiving education foundation funds. These, I don't believe there were any issues that needed to be discussed. I did actually note one on our copy of the student wellness. I don't think the student wellness committee was ever changed to standing. I believe if you look at your copy, it still says advisory committee, and I think we need to change that. So I guess since that is a minor change, and I think everyone agreed on that last time, if it's appropriate, we can, I guess I would like to move that we approve these policies with the one change as noted to change the wording to standing committee.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Questions?
I just one thing to add on the appointment and role of Wellness Advisory Committee. There are two board members, and it appears as though there are three of us, and hopefully that's not a problem if three of us do join.
I think it says at least.
Okay, good.
So further up it says at least, so I don't think that's an issue.
Other questions, comments? All in favor? Thank you. New business. I'm sorry.
I think that who seconded that motion to.
Kevin did.
Kevin did.
Thank you.
Sorry, Mary. Okay, consideration of superintendent's recommendation for athletic fee positions for winter 2006-2007.
The first group that I give you is in your packet from the high school from Keith Weatherby. New coaching recommendations are Maddie Reed as assistant boys basketball. Please note he is a volunteer at level 3. And also Ashley Fifield, freshman girls basketball at 168 hours, level 2, and that is paid by the boosters. Do you want to do them separately, and then I will do the middle school ones.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation for athletic fee positions for the high school.
Is there a second?
Second.
Linda? Questions? All in favor? Thank you. Go ahead, Alan B. Okay.
From the middle school, from Scott Labby, new coaching position is Carrie McCuska, will be middle school Nordic ski. For returning coaches is Robert Yokobaskas, did I do that right?
Mm-hmm.
Who's middle school Nordic ski. Christopher Drake, middle school swimming. Joe Doan, middle school indoor track. Charlie Carroll, middle school indoor track. Tracy Weatherby, middle school indoor track assistant. Megan Greenlaw, eighth grade basketball. And Laurie Fogg, And I notice it says formerly Laurie Broadhurst, so you'll know who that is. Seventh grade basketball.
Great. Do I have a motion?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation for athletic fee positions for the middle school.
Thank you, Rebecca. Second? Thank you, Trish. Discussion? Okay, all in favor? Thank you. Go ahead, Alan.
Mary, do I have any co-curricular fee positions? I don't have any in the
there,
packet.
There should have been a memo in there. There were four from the high school.
It's not in here.
I don't know why it's not in the packet.
No, I don't.
I apologize.
Does somebody have a thing? Okay, great. Thank you very much. Okay, the following are co-curricular fee recommendations for your consideration at the December 12, 2006 meeting. Sharon Merrill, Guidance Department Chair. Dick Mullen, Director for Music. Karen Lamb, Gay Straight Alliance. And Eric Jensen, Robotics.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
Okay. I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation for co-curricular fee positions for the 2006-2007 school year.
Thank you, Rebecca. Second?
Second.
Linda, thank you. Discussion? All in favor? All opposed?
I don't know who that belonged to, so I'll pass that back to Aaron.
Peter, I'm sorry.
Yes, I am opposed.
Okay, thank you. Okay, next one?
The next one is a nomination for teaching position.
Yep.
The first one I have is for Angela Brown, an instructional strategist teacher at Pond Cove. I would ask that Dominic have an opportunity to speak to this one briefly.
Sure. Dominic, thank you.
You have this in your packet. So this is the first position, and I don't know if most of you know, the instructional strategist teacher. We have changed the name of our special ed teachers. Basically, this is because of the stigma that goes along with special ed. For example, just this week, I was at the high school in one of the resource rooms, and I saw a couple students black out sped on their logs that were done by the tech crew. Two this morning at Pond Cove, I had a meeting where the parents refused sped services because of the label, not the service. So I think this is something that a lot of districts, Yarmouth has done this, as well as Cumberland, and I think South Portland has changed their director's name. So I think we're in the most of the teachers have changed their name over to instructional support teacher. This position is the instructional strategist teacher, which is and I don't think the actual job description has gone forward yet, but it is out there and it's coming your way for approval. But basically this position at Pond Cove is a combination of different things. This teacher is going to help facilitate the whole IEP process, from taking the evaluations off of the teachers so they can actually teach, do a lot of the required burden of paperwork, which is developing the IEP cover page, minutes, and prior written notice, to also help starting the process of response to intervention and other type of intervention skills within the classroom, as well as helping deal with multiple things of some of our students who are having difficult behavioral issues. Right now, we have a couple kids that are having some great difficulty, and staff has to race all around. So that's the kind of the goal around that position. And we had several, a lot of different types of people applied. We interviewed three, and Angela Brown is the candidate, and she's a great choice. She was CDS assistant director currently, and she will be coming over here if you guys accept it. And she was also a case manager for CDS. So CDS is Child Development Services, so she knows special ed very well. She has a 282, which is a special ed teacher certification, and the birth 282 certification. It's new. I have that coming your way. So, and she has a bachelor's in regular education. So
And Dominic, would you talk about financing for this? Is it clear that it's not a new position?
Yep, this is not. This is Roxy Johnson's old position. What we did, this was a team decision where my instructional support team at Pond Cove met, and we designed this, her position, to really stay at Pond Cove and help Pond Cove meet the needs of the students at Pond Cove. So the goal is through, and this is not an additional cost at all to the system, so the goal is to put one in each of the buildings. So that's where we're going. That's our goal. If we can do that, that'll be great. So.
Thank you, Dominic.
Dominic, thank you. And I'm also gratified to see that people recognize SPED as a four-letter word.
Yep. One more thing, though. The CDS experience really jumped out at me because the commissioner and DOE are looking at adding 3- and 4-year-olds to our population eventually. So to have her experience in that is going to be a very good asset. So.
Thank you, and thank you for explaining it without too many acronyms so I could keep up with what you were talking about.
Did I make any acronyms?
Yeah, remember. Couple, but okay. You did a great job. Thank you. Okay. Do I have a motion?
I move we accept the hiring of the individual and superintendent's recommendation.
Is there a second? Trish, any discussion, questions? All in favor? Thank you. Consideration of superintendent's nomination to long-term substitute teaching position.
This is a long-term English substitute. If you remember last time, we have a teacher who's going on a maternity leave. And so this is the person to replace her for the remainder of the school year. This is Jonathan Werner. If you look at his resume, Jonathan comes to us with teaching experience at Conestoga High School in Berwyn, Pennsylvania. In the last few years, he has been a lawyer in one of the major law firms here in Portland area and has decided he really wants to go back to teaching again. And so we have hired him. I had an opportunity to sit with him yesterday for 15 or 20 minutes. A very, very excited candidate for the position. As Jeff would tell you the same thing, I know.
Great, thank you. Do I have a motion?
I move that we accept the nomination for the long-term English substitute position.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Sorry.
No, I said thank you, Rebecca.
Yeah.
Is there a second? Thanks, Karen. Discussion? All in favor? Great, thank you. Let's see, consideration of policies for first reading. Trish?
Okay, I guess I'll read these individually.
Whatever.
Or yeah. quickly.
Sure.
I think there's only. The first one is policies. Most of these are in the C section of the policy binder, which deals with central school administration. The first one is policy CA, which is administrative goals, primarily dealing with the superintendent. The policy committee reviewed this and recommended no change. The second one is CB, which is the school superintendent. There were some changes you'll note in red. Don't think they're substantive. I think it's primarily language. CBI, which is evaluation of the superintendent. The policy committee looked at this, and it does. The changes do reflect Drummond Woodsum recommendations, and I think if you read through it, it seemed to me that it reflected the policy that we just went through, which we know worked fairly well with some tweaking. So I think that does allow for that to continue. CHD, which is administration in policy absence. That was shortened. DF, which is fundraising. We did not recommend any changes to this policy. And DFR, which is fundraising administrative procedures. There were some changes in the language to that, some clarification and some clarification, I'll leave it at that, and also to differentiate or take out CEF from this policy, because if you recall, we approved a policy specific to CEF in November, I think. So I will move that...
Well, this is first reading.
Oh, so I don't need to move?
I don't think so.
I just need to ask if there are any questions as to whether or not the policy committee needs to consider. Thank you.
Questions for Trish or...
Not at this point.
I did have just one quick question on the administrative goals. The purpose of school administration is to help create and foster an environment in which pupils can learn most effectively. I just wasn't sure if there would be any mention of also the... creating like the staff development and everything else, if there was some component of the teacher aspect in there. I just didn't see that reflected in there.
That's a good question.
It might not be appropriate in that.
So you, I'm sorry, Karen, what you're asking is there also a teacher one like this?
No, I'm actually asking about incorporating the teacher aspect into the purpose of what the school administration is supposed to do. It seems very student-centered, which it should be, but also I would think it should be teachers-focused as well. Does that make sense?
I think perhaps then, I think we ought to take a look at that at the, the next meeting and see where it goes.
We'll do that. Make note of that. Thank you, Karen.
Other questions for Trish? Okay. Let's see. Consideration of recommendation from Personnel Committee regarding job descriptions. Linda?
The Personnel Committee has been continuing its efforts to our job descriptions as well as evaluation forms. And in our last meeting, we went through job descriptions for the superintendent, the administrative assistant to the superintendent, payroll and benefits supervisor, accounts payable supervisor, and the accounts payable clerk and receptionist. Many of these job descriptions have been gone through by several of the administration staff, Alan, as well as Pauline. We've accepted their recommendations as presented in the packet tonight. So I'd like to make a motion to accept. Do you want me to do these individually or?
Probably ought to, for record's sake, is to do one at a time.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to accept the recommendation for job description for superintendent of schools.
For a second. Rebecca? Discussion? All in favor? Thank you. Linda?
I would like to make a motion to accept the job description for administrative assistant to the superintendent.
For a second. Right here. Trish? Discussion? All in favor? Sorry, Mary. Okay.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the job description for payroll and benefits supervisor.
Second?
Second.
Kevin? Discussion? All in favor? Okay. Linda?
Would like to make a motion to accept the job description for accounts payable supervisor.
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. Discussion? All in favor? Thank you.
Finally, would like to make a motion to accept the job description for accounts payable clerk and receptionist.
Second.
Thanks, Kevin. Discussion? All in favor? Okay. Let's see. Next, consideration of request from high school teacher regarding out-of-state field trips.
You have the copy of the request from him, I believe, in your packets. This is from Ted Jordan at the high school. Originally, we had planned to bring this to the January meeting until we realized that one of the trips is in early February. So we knew we had to do it. The reason it's coming to you is because they are overnight trips, and they are beyond the miles that I am approved to do them on my own. Talked with Ted today. This has been presented to you, I think, well, last year, I know, and I think prior to that, this has been fairly common procedure. He has taken care of all the issues around transportation, insurances, all of the other pieces that go with that. And these are directly connected to his United States history classes at Cape Elizabeth High School.
Is there a motion?
I move to endorse the trips requested by Ted Jordan as they fit the criteria we've established, and they are also directly curriculum-related.
Is there a second?
Second.
Rebecca?
Questions?
I don't have any this time.
I don't know. Any other questions, comments? All in favor? Opposed? Okay. Consideration of approval of funds for truck purchase. Alan?
What you have in front, getting at this point in time is I had emailed you a couple of weeks ago about the fact we have a dead truck. Dead trucks do not tend to do a lot of work around the system. So what we are looking at is the fact that we have a 1994 pickup, which we purchased in the beginning for $3,500. It has died. In order to have it repaired and brought into working order, it's going to cost at least $2,000, which does not seem like a logical investment by the school district. At the same time, we don't feel we have the kind of money to look at a brand new truck. Ernie McVain, who works with Public Works, and Steve Young, the bus maintenance worker, went out and checked around to find a truck, which is a used truck. Basically, these trucks are used to transport trash from the schools and other town buildings to the transfer station. What we have found, the best buy we could find, and we have had several people do some looking for us, is a truck which is priced at $7,800. They will sell it to us for $6,824, and the truck could serve us for up to from 5 to 8 years. The funds would come from the high school contracted services and CIP budget in the amount of $4,324 and $2,500 from the MSPC contracted services account. So the total cost is $6,824. I should mention, I will add one more thing to this, because I had brought this to the Finance Committee. A couple of questions that were asked of us is, number one, would we check local other local areas to see if they have trucks that we could rent on a regular basis to do this? And what we found was we checked Southport, we checked three or four districts, and those were not available, particularly to do the timing of what we need to do. We tried to use some trucks that were in the system. Again, because of timing, it was very difficult to do that. So we truly do need a truck to take care of the garbage. This is lunchtime garbage. This is the regular garbage that comes from the school district and also comes from the other buildings within the school system.
Thank you. Is there a motion?
I move that we approve a purchase of a truck for the use of transporting trash and other facility requirements.
Is there a second?
Second.
Kevin? Discussion?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
In this particular instance, we've missed an opportunity to think a little bit differently than we have in the past. And as a result, we spent a lot of money that could be used directly for the support of education rather than simply transfer of trash to the town dump. The cost of the truck could have been purchased for a lot less. I attended a State Bureau of Surplus Vehicle auction for the firm of my of Goodwill Industries last week. We purchased a number of cars. There were over 100 used trucks, anywhere from 3 to 4 years old, out of the state motor pool. They were all sold for about $3,000.
Oh, for goodness sakes.
And this sale is held about every 3 months. It's open to what they call donees, nonprofits, school departments, towns, whatever. And we just missed an opportunity. Also, the cost of getting our town trash to the town transfer station is actually close to $40,000 a year, because we use two town employees during the day for about 2.5 hours. These are normally school bus drivers in between runs are members of the custodial staff. At night, the same dump run is done with two members of the custodial staff. If you look at cost of benefits, cost of workers' comp, cost of the truck, it's $40,000 to $50,000 a year. I believe we can get our town trash to the town transfer station for a lot less than $40,000 a year. And we just missed an opportunity to generate funds to fill a teaching position, to fill a teacher's aid position, to use for education, which is what we're here for.
Yeah. I think you opened an issue for us, Peter, we didn't know about, so I really appreciate that. And perhaps we could talk more about that so we can become a part of that process. because I had not heard anything about it whatsoever, because I certainly would not want to overlook something like that if it's available without any question.
For example, Mr. Hawkins, I purchased a 2000 Buick Century with 70,000 miles on it for $2,800.
Is that right?
I purchased a 2003 Chevy Cavalier for $2,200. And I purchased a 2001 Dodge Intrepid for $3,100 yep. to be used in my program, which is the Goodwheels program of Goodwill yep. Industries. And
but any nonprofit can belong?
Any nonprofit can belong.
That's good to know, because I had not.
Just a simple matter of asking for an invitation, you'll be sent
okay.
auction sheets. And it's not an auction. They set the prices.
And then you can go up and.
And if there's anything major wrong with the vehicle, you can bring it back.
Okay. Very good. Yeah, if I can get more information from you, yep. I think that's something that would be very valuable for us. Plus,
I realize we missed the opportunity this time, yep. but if we ever need a vehicle for school department use,
yep. it's very good.
It
to
can
know.
Be purchased.
Super. Thank you very much for that information.
Other comments? Okay. All in favor? Okay. Let's see. Consideration of citizen appointments to Community Services Advisory Board.
There are two different sheets there with different names on them. And there are two there. Each one has a different name.
Do you want me to go? You go ahead.
Yeah, this is one I'm going to be more than honest with you, I know very little about. If you were at the board meeting, town council meeting last night, you know they talked about the different citizen boards. And that there is a citizen boards committee who interviews people for these. Apparently, on the Community Services Advisory Board, two of the positions they look for are people who, if I'm not mistaken, and Mary will probably help me because I have had her do some checking for me, would be representing the school system on these. Mary, do you have more information about that?
Well, the way the board is set up, the Community Services Advisory Board, they have two or three members that are appointed by the school board, and then they have other members that are appointed by the town council. And this year, two of the appointees of the school board's terms have expired, and these two people have volunteered. I know that Courtney was highly recommended by Sue Weatherby. She's familiar with her and is looking forward to having her on the board. And then the
Peter
other
Daly.
Recommendation,
Peter Daly.
The committee that did the interviewing was very impressed with him and felt that he would serve us well, and recommended that the board approve his appointment.
So these two names were brought to us from the committee. You can take a look at these, or if you want to look at other people to apply for this, we can do that also. Again, this is a whole new one. I had not seen this before, and so I said I would bring it to you tonight to take a look at, and perhaps some of you have served on some of these committees and know a little more about it than I do.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept the recommendations of the citizens to the Community Services Advisory Board.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Mm-hmm. Second.
Thank you, Karen. Any discussion? All in favor?
Okay, that's done.
Thank you. Okay, let's see. Committee reports. Standing committees. Finance Committee, Rebecca?
The Finance Committee met on November 28th in the superintendent's office. Kathy, Linda, and I, Alan, Pauline, and Ernie were in attendance. We signed warrants. A great deal of the meeting was centered around the 2007-2008 capital improvement plan that was presented by Ernie. A great deal of discussion centered around the need for a new district truck, which turns out was actually not a CIP forecast need, but actually a current need. The committee did ask Pauline and Ernie to investigate the possibility of sharing a public works truck or sharing with a surrounding community, just so we can make sure that we looked at all the avenues of trying to save some money for the town. and apparently there was not a lot of success in doing that. I would like to share that the plan does forecast a 73% increase over current year budget. 50% of this increase, however, is attributable to security systems upgrade for school buildings, which originally Alan and Pauline had hoped would be addressed by a grant, which we've been given initial indication that we will not be receiving that money. So Ernie has included that equipment in his CIP plan. The CIP forecast is required by the town council every year at this time, with the understanding that the school board has yet to begin the budget process. So these numbers are just ballpark, it's a forecast, and it's going to be up for discussion during the budget process. The food service report was reviewed. The level of negative student accounts is rising, so the committee did ask Pauline to take a closer look at what is happening. We did note some good news, however, that there were substantially lower inventory amounts carried month to month, which reflects improved inventory management by Sue and food services program. Currently, we are in good shape regarding our energy costs due to mild weather to date. Let's hope that continues, but not too warm because we all want snow to be able to play in. And finally, Alan, at the end of the meeting, expressed some concern over the potential impact of changes resulting from future wellness policies and asked that that be kept in consideration as these policies are deliberated.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Oh, I'm sorry. And the next meeting is December 19th, 12:30, in the superintendent's office. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. Policy Committee, Trish.
I think most of the work that we, votes that we've taken covered most of the business. The policy committee met last on November 14th. The only policy that we discussed that was not presented for first or second reading was pandemic policy, which is still in process. Alan's working on that. We had a meeting scheduled for December 19th, but that will not take place, so we will meet again in January. I should have checked the date, the 3rd. We'll be meeting on January 16th at 12 noon.
Thank you, Trish. Communication Committee, Trish.
We have not met since the last meeting. The next meeting is tomorrow at 3 o'clock at the Pond Cove Media Center.
Thank you. Personnel Committee, Linda.
Personnel Committee met on November 30th. We reviewed the job descriptions as presented at earlier tonight in tonight's meeting. We also started review of the administrative assistant job descriptions for Pond Cove, the middle school, and we're currently waiting for those from the high school. So those will probably be presented at our next meeting. We also started discussion as far as reviewing the superintendent's evaluation form and making some minor changes to that, and again, that will be brought up to the board at a future meeting. That was the majority of our last meeting, which was held right after our emergency situation the day before, so our meeting was cut a bit short. Our next meeting is going to be held in January. The date has not as yet been set.
Thank you, Linda. Strategic Planning Committee, Trish.
First, I want to extend a thank you to the faculty and staff and the administrators for attending the workshop on Monday, November 20th. There was a lot of time that was invested in discussions around the beliefs which support our mission and vision statement. And we are in the process of receiving the data which resulted from the discussions that day. I also want to thank those community members who attended the November 28th school board workshop. Similar discussions were had at that meeting, providing us an opportunity to hear from a different group of school district stakeholders. In a moment, I'm going to ask Shari Robinson, whose participation in this process has been invaluable, to update you on the results of that meeting. Next in the process is a community dialogue day scheduled for January 26th. Participants will include representatives from the teaching school staffs, as well as community members. This meeting will repeat some of the activities which took place in the previous two meetings, so it will allow for consistent data collection. However, this meeting, we hope, will take it a step further, producing a shared community school picture of what goals should be pursued by the district over the next 2 years. The committee will be meeting in early January, but we have not yet set a date. Should we let Shari come on, or should we consider?
Sure, no, that's fine.
If you wouldn't mind, Shari, thank you.
Thank you, Shari.
Hot off the press, as it were.
We, so I'm to speak to you about our school board workshop, and we asked a group of 13 community members and some school board members. Those school board members who had participated with the faculty did not necessarily need to participate with us that evening, although they were welcome to add their expertise. And we asked them to answer the question, what we want for Cape Elizabeth Schools, by describing what would be happening if the following six beliefs existed. And those beliefs were that we are one of the top public school systems in the United States, that education is a shared responsibility among students, teachers, staff, parents, and the community, that our community expects, values, and supports excellence in teaching, that education prepares students to become competent individuals and productive citizens, that all students are challenged and supported in their learning, that teachers have time for collaboration, reflection, and professional development on a regular, consistent basis. And as I looked over the charts that were created after several hours of work, their responses could be consolidated within six. There were six major themes that came from the results of their efforts. the first theme was under community. And the comments under community included community programs integrated with the school, community assessment of schools, staff, administration, citizens, use of multiple methods for assessment, assessment of postgraduate success, parent education training provided, more active role from parents without children in the community, and values taught to children that reinforce the community standards and accountability. The theme of culture included positive energy and positive climate, a culture that supports entrepreneurial skills and excellence, and stronger guidance at the post-elementary level. And technology, it was agreed upon that we needed to keep our equipment and our resources, our software up to date, that there were rich, diverse, and challenging programs, and that professional development integrated teaching and technology. Comments about teaching, adequate pay commensurate with local and national standards, collaborative negotiations, financial and calendar support for professional development, neuropsych training, and common planning and collaboration. Under the theme of learning, integrated cross-subject, rounded curriculum to address diverse needs, problem-solving, gifted and talented program, intellectually challenging, and personalized learning plans. And there were several comments that really just talked about healthy students that are part of our system. And those included respectful, ethically accountable students, students with a strong voice, students actively engaged, and honored and respected for their individuality. I also offered, I don't know what I was thinking, to come up with to find a way to put all of that feedback into three sentences. I'm smiling at Mary. Thank you, Mary, for your help. And I did get, we did have comments and came back. I made the mistake of saying, and here are my ideas, but if I've left anything out, let me know. Well, I left some, it was very hard to put it all together. But here's an attempt, and I think maybe it's a work in progress, Trish. One, in recognition of the individual strengths and needs of each student, a personalized learning plan is developed and monitored for each student with input from the student, parents, and teachers. Two, the Cape Elizabeth Learning Community encompasses all stakeholders in a shared exchange of expertise with common understanding of the values inherent in a high-quality education, including a system for, one, collecting assessment information about school programs from the wider community, two, implementing changes indicated by the assessments, and three, disseminating the assessment information to all parties. And the third one, the Cape Elizabeth community recognizes the relationship between the value of empowered and passionate teachers and happy, healthy, successful students, and fosters that relationship with adequate compensation and benefit packages, coupled with exemplary professional development opportunities for all educators. I'm laughing because Linda, at the end of our 2.5 hours, Linda showed, was it from Minnesota?
Yeah.
It was just like really one sentence, and it was very clear, and I cringe to read this in front of you, Linda, after you,
no,
after what you gave us, but that really is an attempt to take a lot of wonderful feedback and try to put it in some way that we can work with, and also add to the work that was done by the teachers and the administrators on November 28th.
Shari, this is great. I think you really should be very proud of what I can't imagine doing what you've just accomplished in these. You may think they're long, but I saw the reams of paper that was generated from those 2 days and all the wonderful ideas and energy and passion, and you've boiled it down very succinctly, so thank you for doing that.
Thank you very much. I was glad to participate in it. Thank you.
Thank you, Shari.
Thank you, Shari.
Okay, great. thanks, Trish. Let's see, Student Extracurricular Committee, Linda.
The Extracurricular Committee last met on December 5th. Most of the discussions at the meeting were centered on the turf field as far as a current situation where we were with the project itself. Alan Hawkins actually ran the meeting and provided us with some updates concerning the financial aspect as far as where contributions were to date, and that there was an agreement from the Kids Turf Committee to carry the debt on the balance due. He also provided us with some information concerning the actual field itself, what it was going to look like, and discussions started centering around additional fencing that may be required around the field. We got some feedback from the police chief, as well as Bob Malley, what the structure may need to look like. We do have some meetings coming up with Portland regarding their field, what they have done to help maintain the field during games and crowd control, et cetera. So most of the discussions did center around some of the issues we are going to be facing as the turf project moves forward. Over the next several months, the committee plans on addressing these issues one by one and updating our policies as they relate to the field so that we do have good policy in place by the time the field is complete. Our next meeting is tomorrow at 2:15.
I'm sorry, if I just may add, Alan sent out an email recently, and I just wanted to start publicizing it now because I think it's really great. Sue Weatherby has worked really hard to get sports done right, mm-hmm. to come here to Cape Elizabeth, and I think we're looking at a couple of dates, but I just want to get, it's going to be in January, so everybody keep your eyes out, ears open to just wait to hear what the date is.
Thank you, Rebecca. I actually had it down here and then forgot to say it.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Linda. Kevin, PATHS?
Yes, I spent a few hours over at PATHS today, and I'm going to use this as a teaching moment for the rest of the board as well. Working on the what we refer to as the Part 2 budget. I've provided all of you with the recommended Part 2 budget for 2007 and 2008, as well as a copy of the 2006-07 budget. Part 2 budget relates strictly to the replacement of equipment that is necessary to run the individual programs. You have a detailed list of the equipment that has been requested of the General Advisory Committee at PASS. We have, for the last three, perhaps 4 years, kept this piece of the budget fairly steady annually at about $144,000 to $145,000. The faculty and the coordinators over at PASS are really good at working out their priorities amongst themselves, with people deferring requests in favor of more necessary equipment. And that's one of the key factors in being able to come in at a reasonable number each year. What happens here is this will, I will be presenting this budget to the General Advisory Committee on Thursday. I anticipate that it will pass, and we will then bring back to this board our portion of this budget. I don't have the numbers yet, but I believe it will be less than $8,000, as our attendance, although our attendance this year is down, the calculation is based on a rolling average of the prior 2 years' attendance. So that if there is a significant change in an individual district's participation, there will not be a huge whack to their individual budgets in any one given year. If you have questions after the later on, you have plenty of time to look at this, go through it. There is also a Part 1 budget, which has not been determined yet. Part 1 is essentially the administration and the faculty and the upkeep of the building. And that is also apportioned out if you want to be what we call a sending school. It's apportioned out, and it's also apportioned based on two-year average attendance. I think our number usually comes out, my best guess is last year, I think it was 1.9% of the budget. So more bang for the buck than we can replicate here on our own. That's where we are on this, and I'm hopeful that on January I'll be presenting to you the budget, the full PASS budget, so that we can take action on it. The other things that are going on right now is, as Alan and I have not participated that I'm aware of at this point, but there is a new literacy committee going on at all VOTEC vocational technical schools at the request of the State Department of Education, that VOTEC schools also accept partial responsibility for literacy. To that end, they have PASS is great, are great users of what is that? Call Perkins?
Yes.
Yeah. Call Perkins grant. So that we now have a literacy coach that costs no one, not the sending schools or anyone else, any money at all. And their version of what we're trying to do with the NWEA data gathering is to use AccuPlacer. I personally have used AccuPlacer. It's a very interesting and pretty telling assessment exam, computerized assessment exam. They've run through their first 70 through 72 students and are using that information not only for themselves but also for the sending schools. The new programs are all up and running. Those were also funded through Carl Perkins grants, small engine repair, and we're working right now on a new communications technology program that will bring us up to date in terms of fiber technologies, things like that. So there are exciting things happening, both programmatically and, you know, it's just, it's a good place to come visit. I know it's late notice, but, and I thought I had sent out invitations, but if anybody has the time to come along Thursday, it'll run from noon. Food's pretty good, and I don't think this particular meeting's going to go much beyond one. We have three items on the budget, and as Alan knows, I've been pretty good for the last few years at getting those meetings done under the gun. So again, if any one board member, I'm reluctant to bring more than one board member at a time without prior blessing. And I can also arrange for a tour of the building for everybody if we can get a small group together. The administration over there would be more than happy to take us on a tour of all the different programs. I've taken up enough time.
Thank you, Kevin. Sounds interesting. If anybody wants to go, should they contact you?
Please.
Okay. Technology Committee, Linda?
The Technology Planning Committee has had two meetings since our last board meeting, the first of which was a presentation by Sylvia Norton from the Department of Education. She came down to review the criteria that our new updated plan is going to require. The plan that we will be submitting, Gary Lanois is heading up the committee, will encompass not only our school system, but also the library system. Our second meeting, which was held on November 15th, began the process, the actual working process of the committee, to start looking at our existing technology plan and updating it. And our discussion started around the actual format of the plan. We also looked at plans from other districts as well as the national technology plan. Gary has taken the time already to take our existing plan and actually put it out on the website. So I passed out to everyone here tonight a link. So you can actually go out and look at our working draft document as we proceed. Our next meeting is scheduled for December 20th, and we're going to start working on the goals of the plan.
Thank you, Linda. Let's see. I was going to ask for public comment on anything on the agenda, but I don't think I see anybody from the public here, so I guess we'll pass on that. School board agenda requests. Anybody have a request for the agenda for next month? No? Okay. I'll just go over the upcoming meetings again. The Policy Committee's meeting, January 16th at noon, mm-hmm. in the Jordan Conference Room.
Mm-hmm.
Extracurriculars meeting Wednesday, December 13th from 2:15 to 4 o'clock in the superintendent's office. Communications Committee is meeting Wednesday, December 13th, 305 Pond Cove Media Center. Technology Committee is Wednesday, December 20th, 2:30 to 4 o'clock. Where? Jordan Conference Room. Finance Committee is meeting Tuesday, December 19th. From 12:30 to 1:30 at the superintendent's office. School board workshop, there'll be no December school board meeting, but the next one will be Tuesday, January 23rd at 7 p.m. in the high school library. The town council school board workshop is scheduled for Wednesday, January 3rd, time and place to be determined. The next school board business meeting is Tuesday, January 9th at 7 p.m. in the council chambers. And the strategic planning workshop is Friday, January 26th, 8 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. in the high school cafeteria. Anything that I've missed or no?
Yeah. No, I just saw that 8 a.m. to 12:30. That's long, but I now remember what that's all.
Okay. So, seeing no information, I'd entertain a motion to adjourn. Second.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor? Thank you very much.
3 minutes.
Thank you.
No, per person in January. What did you say?